What are the prediabetic symptoms and how is prediabetes defined? What tests are needed to confirm the diagnosis? New research has shown how to stop the progression of prediabetes dead in its tracks. You can avoid becoming a full-blown diabetic along with all the devastating health issues associated with disease with just a little understanding of what causes diabetes in the first place. What you will undoubtedly learn today will change your life for the better. The sooner the truth is realized, the faster your body can and will heal itself. But before we begin, let me welcome all of you resilient diabetics out there. This is the channel we turn ordinary struggling diabetics into extraordinary well-controlled diabetics. If you don't know who I am and you are brand new to this channel, I welcome you. My name is Jay Sampat, and I became an insulin-dependent diabetic a little over 6 years ago due to an autoimmune attack which caused the destruction of my pancreas as a result of a severe gluten allergy response. So basically, I am the proud owner of a pancreas that's gone on a permanent and lifelong vacation. So not only am I a diabetic, just like you, where we will be walking that walk and talking that talk together, but I do also have a University of Bachelor of Science degree in nutrition dietetics, and that does come in very handy in discussing all the intricacies of being a diabetic. The unique information presented today will only be found here on this channel, The Resilient Diabetic. New, life-changing episodes are released weekly. So if you want to learn more and you want to be notified by YouTube that a new video has been published, then the only way to do that is to hit that subscribe button followed by the gray notification bell and then choose turn on all notifications. And of course, if you liked what you've learned today, please smash that like button for me. As with all my videos, this should not be considered personal medical advice. This is my interpretation of the latest research. If you want medical advice, please always consult your physician. What is absolutely shocking, but true, approximately 84 million American adults, more than 1 in 3, have prediabetes. And that ratio will only get worse. What's more, 90% of people with prediabetes don't even know they have it. 25% of those with prediabetes will progress to full-blown type 2 diabetes in approximately 3 to 5 years. And as many as 70% of individuals with prediabetes will develop overt diabetes within their lifetime. This is the new modern world's pandemic. There are no exceptions to this rule. The only difference, this is not a contagious disease or passed from person to person. So around the world, the number of people with diabetes has risen from 108 million in 1980 to around 422 million in 2014. Based on the way we are going and the fact our healthcare experts are in complete denial of the true cause of diabetes, those numbers will get far, far worse. Now, those with prediabetes generally do not show any signs or symptoms just yet. If you do have prediabetes, the long-term damage of diabetes, especially to the heart, the eyes, the nervous tissue, the blood vessels, and the kidneys, is just in the very beginning, early stages. The damage to these very delicate body cells has actually just gotten started. That is because your blood sugar levels are higher than normal, but not high enough for you to be diagnosed technically as a type 2 diabetic. Just in case you were wondering, the other name for prediabetic is borderline diabetes. That is one in the same. The term prediabetes, as defined by the ADA, comprises of borderline glycemia, generally measured by one of these three tests. The first one is called the fasting plasma glucose test. The second one, the hemoglobin A1c test. And the third is called the 2-hour plasma glucose test. The first test we mentioned was the fasting blood sugar test. Fasting blood sugar is the blood sugar levels before you eat in the morning when you wake up. The ranges for fasting blood sugar test are normal, between 70 to 99 milligrams a deciliter. Prediabetes is defined between 100 and 125 milligrams a deciliter, whereas diabetes is higher than 126 milligrams per deciliter. If your fasting blood sugar tests show that you have prediabetes, your doctors may want to do what's known as the hemoglobin A1c test to confirm. This test provides information about your average blood sugar levels over the past 3 months. The results are reported as a percentage this time. Normal is below or around 5.6. Prediabetes is between 5.7 to around 6.3. Diabetes is 6.4 or higher. The first problem here. There are different thresholds from country to country, institution to institution, healthcare provider to healthcare provider, doctor to doctor. The cutoffs are all different. One may say 6.2 and over is a sign of overt diabetes. Another, 6.5. And that doesn't do you any good. The 2-hour oral glucose tolerance test is the third possible test your doctor may order for you. For this test, a healthcare provider will take your baseline fasting glucose levels first. Then they will ask you to drink 8 ounces of a syrupy glucose solution that contains around 75 grams of sugar. You will then wait 2 hours, where you will get your blood drawn 2 more times to see how your body responded to the glucose consumed. There is one important component every pre-diabetic should know, because this is where the first piece of the puzzle comes in when it comes to your health. What are the normal blood sugar ranges for those without diabetes or prediabetes? Fasting blood sugars in the morning before eating are between 70 to 90 milligrams per deciliter, not 100. 1 hour after a meal, it will rise to around 90 to 130. 5 or more hours after eating, it's back to that baseline of 70 to 90 milligrams per deciliter. Let me repeat this because it is so critical. 5 or more hours after eating, it is back to that baseline of 70 to 90 milligrams a deciliter. During the day, levels tend to be the lowest just before meals. This is the gold standard for blood sugar metabolism. The blood sugar ranges for prediabetes is 100 to 125. This is not rocket science here, and this is where most make their biggest mistake of their lives. These numbers are arbitrary at best. So someone with blood sugars at 124 is not diabetic, but someone with blood sugars at 125 is? A big shock recently came from a British study that looked at A1C levels in people with and without diabetes. Regardless of whether a person had diabetes, the study showed that for every 1% increase in A1C, upped the risk of death from all causes by 24% in men and 28% in women. Nearly 3/4 of all the deaths in the study came from people with moderately elevated hemoglobin A1C levels between 5 and 6.9. In people with type 2 diabetes, they found every 1% increase in the A1C added an 18% risk of heart disease, and there was a 28% jump in risk of peripheral vascular disease. So every 1% change is clinically significant to our health. Period, end of story. Don't let anyone fool you and justify high blood sugar levels. So we can see already blood sugars in pre-diabetics are already elevated. If you do a Google search on pre-diabetic symptoms, your very, very top result will say, quote unquote, the exact cause of pre-diabetes is unknown. Unknown, and it will continue to say, but family history and genetics appear to play an important role. Absolute nonsense and utter hogwash. 1 in 3 have it now. What do they all have in common? And this is where the greatest of human diet mandates has gone terribly wrong. And it's staring everyone right in the face. We do know what causes prediabetes, and so do our experts. But because of our ingrained lifestyle and strongly held beliefs, there will be no change for society as a whole. The pandemic will continue to snowball, but that will be different for you now, as you will find out why, and it will all come together for you very, very shortly. So to begin with, we have to rewind and understand how the human body was fueled and fed prior to, say, the 1900s. one must understand the human body was first designed to move and to be active. It is built, hardwired into our DNA. We moved and we were in motion all day long. And that physical activity was expanded to gain and acquire one thing, our food. So basically, one ate accordingly to fuel the body for the whole day. And what types of foods sustain mankind from day one? Nutrient-rich, protein-rich foods. Past generations had to hunt or to gather, or in modern society, they had to walk to work. They had to walk home, tend the farm, had to physically work throughout the day without any of the modern comforts. Hard, manual labor was the cornerstone for humankind from day one. From the second one got up from bed until they went to sleep, they were basically in motion. Prior generations did not get up, eat a bowl of oatmeal, bread, milk, juice, all carbohydrates, get into the car, drive to work, take the elevator up, only to eat more carbohydrate snacks and drinks, sit in front of the computer for a few more hours, then get back into the car, and then have lunch somewhere, eat more carbohydrates like a sandwich with some kind of chips, carbs, a drink, carbs, and then eat more snacks at work while sitting there, more carbs, drive home, and then have a heavy carb-laden dinner, sit on the couch, and then binge-fest a little TV while eating another carbohydrate snack or dessert. So our healthcare experts out there still promote the excessive consumption of carbohydrates, even the healthy ones, in a society that is no longer in motion or is physically active. And if you have not noticed, that includes our children too. Not only is everything our children are exposed to essentially pure sugar, but they are less active than any other generation. So essentially, what is the body to do with all that extra carbohydrates coming in day after day when the body's fuel stores are full because there's no physical activity? And does it matter if those carbohydrates are healthy, like whole grains, if it's not using it for energy? And this is where the lesson on diabetes begins, regardless of type. Once carbohydrates are consumed in excess, and it does not matter if it comes from a can of soda or a bowl of rice or whole grain breads, the body now has to find a place to store it because it's not being used due to inactivity and our stores are already full. What does that lead to? Yes, you guessed it. A metabolic disorder called diabetes. And this disorder simply revolves around two things: glucose or sugars and insulin production, as I will physiologically explain now. Glucose is one of the fuels the body can use for energy, and the pancreas produces a hormone called insulin. Insulin drives glucose from the blood into our body cells to be either used directly as immediate energy, or if it's consumed in excess, it then gets converted into a fat known as a triglyceride, where it is stored for future use. These triglycerides are then stored in a number of locations depending on your genes. And this is the bomb drop the radical new research has just revealed. The excessive carbs we are eating, both quote unquote the good ones like whole grain breads, pastas, the starches like sweet potatoes, and the bad ones like packaged refined carbohydrates and sodas, are being converted into these triglycerides by the liver. And they can either be stored as fats subcutaneously. These are the fats directly under the skin that can be seen. This is the fat that hangs, that can be pinched by your fingers. Ironically, this is the healthy way of fat storage and does not cause insulin resistance or much health issues. It just looks unattractive. So just to reiterate, the fats, these triglycerides, are not coming from the fats we eat, but from the excessive carbohydrates that are being consumed. Now, in your case, or in the case of many full-blown type 2 diabetics, fats are now being stored where it cannot be seen, which is inside the liver, deep within the muscle tissues, and in between all the body organs, not subcutaneously underneath the skin. This phenomenon explains why most pre-diabetics do not look diabetic. They are not fat or obese in any way. Some are even skinny. These unseen fats deep inside the body then cause what's known as insulin resistance, meaning the insulin the body produces fails at driving glucose into the cells to be used for energy. Thus, glucose then floats around in higher and higher amounts, damaging the body's nerves and the small blood vessels from the inside out. In the case of a prediabetic, the pancreas is starting to get burnt out and the fats on the inside of the body are causing insulin resistance at the very same time. These fats are causing even further destruction to the pancreas because it's now having to work harder and harder to make more and more insulin. The reason you want to stop this and stop this now is because years of the pancreas beta cells having to pump out ever increasing higher and higher amounts of insulin because of the resistance then just begins its own demise. It just gets tired and worn out. But another important point to factor in, all this occurs years, sometimes decades prior to being diagnosed. So by the time of diagnosis, 50% of the beta cell functioning may have already been lost for many diabetics. And for many type 2 diabetics, it just continues to completely fail over time, turning them technically into type 1 diabetics too. So as time progresses, the amounts of blood sugars just keeps rising and rising, damaging all the body organs, the blood vessels, the nervous tissues throughout the body until the day it's been caught. But what is the great news? Progression from prediabetes to type 2 diabetes is not inevitable. Why? You now know what causes it, and starting today, you can start to implement a solid game plan. If you have prediabetes, the best way to avoid developing type 2 diabetes is by starting with lifestyle changes. First, you can lose a little bit of weight if you are overweight. Just losing 7% of your starting weight can help delay or prevent diabetes. That means if you weigh 200 pounds, losing, say, 14 pounds can make a huge difference. This is because the pancreas does not have to work so hard, making it more efficient. Exercise regularly. Exercise is an important part of diabetes prevention, and you now know why. The human body was meant and designed to be active. Exercise helps remove all those toxic fats stored inside the muscle tissue. It then allows glucose to be taken up by the muscles instead of those triglyceride-based fats, thus lowering the amounts of sugar in the blood. You must find some time in your day to become physically active. This could include a brisk walk, riding a bike, or swimming. You have to ask your doctor what exercise level is safe for you. Following a healthy diet. This is where all the confusion comes in. What is a healthy diet? Is it a food guide pyramid diet where our esteemed experts still irresponsibly hold as good for you? What about the extremes like a vegan diet or a keto diet? Do they work? Should we consume or eat foods like fruits or whole grains? What I can say is this. What is true for a full-blown diabetic is true for you. Meaning, the amount of carbs you eat is what's really going to matter. To end this confusion for you, I will set up a playlist with a multitude of videos that will cover the foods and carbs I do recommend and why. The carbs that not only have my A1Cs in the low fives, but just as importantly, have me using the least amounts of insulin so my blood sugars remain flatlined and well controlled all day long. That then keeps this old diabetic feeling energetic and looking great, as you can now see. If you're on your desktop or laptop, use that mouse to click that upcoming box. If you're on your mobile device, tap that with your fingers. The first is the link to subscribe to this all-important life-changing channel. The second is the link to the playlist I will create for you with the videos I've just mentioned. So, have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another new episode, which I said are always released weekly. Bye for now.